this continues where we left off this morning. So we have been gradually going through the gradual training, which is appropriate. And so far we have been looking at the things that correspond to the first four factors of the noble eightfold path. And the next one here really corresponds to right livelihood of the noble eightfold path. But keep in mind, this is still we're dealing with monasticism here, so it's like a monastic version of that. And I will talk a little bit about how it relates to lay life as well. So this is what happens next. He becomes content with robes to protect his body and with arms to maintain his stomach. And wherever he goes, he sets out, taking only these with him. Just as a bird, wherever it goes.
Okay.
Sorry.
Just as a... Oops, lost it. Yeah.
No.
Hello? Anyone out there? Hello. Okay, now. Hold it for a second. So there's the other one? No, there we are, back again. Okay. Just as a bird, wherever it goes, flies with its wings. It's a bit loud. Can we do anything here?
No.
No?
Maybe you can move a bit more?
Okay.
Oh, maybe.
Okay. Like this?
I don't know.
How's that? Is that better? Can you? Okay, let's try that. See what happens. So, just as a bird, wherever it goes, flies with its wings and its only burden, so too a bhikkhu becomes content with robes to protect his body and with alms food to maintain his stomach. And wherever he goes, he sets out, taking only these with him. Possessing this attribute, or this sun, if you like, of noble virtue, he experiences within himself the bliss that is blameless. So here you see the kind of the basic requisites for a monastic. It's only two things really. It's the alms bowl and the robe. That's really all you are supposed to take with you. Whenever you go anywhere in the world, that is what you take with you. So there is supposed to be a very simple life. It's very rare to find anyone living fully up to this ideal, but there are some people who come remarkably close, even in the present day, to living exactly like this. And you have this beautiful simile here, just as a bird, wherever it goes, flies with its wings as its only burden. You set out your wings, they're still like a burden, but obviously not much. And in the same way, you have kind of the very bare necessities. And this is, of course, the right livelihood for a monastic, because you have to have a ball to be able to survive. That is kind of the basis for the monastic life, especially in ancient times. And even today, in large parts of Asia, there are still lots of monastics who every day they go into the local village, and they carry the ball with them, and they receive alms food from the local population. Very beautiful, actually, to see this kind of ancient ceremony still happening in the present day. And very kind of quite inspiring. Then you live on that. Where people give you that, that is what you live on. So it is very simple. You have to be easily contented. If you are too demanding, you're not going to be very happy in that kind of situation. So you have to have that sense of contentment if this is going to work out for you. And this is really what this is about, this passage about contentment. The purpose of contentment is that we are here kind of moving from the ordinary virtues in life, being kind to others and these kind of things. And now we're moving into the mental virtues in a sense. Because when you are content, it means you have less desires, you have less ill will and all these kind of things. So we're now gradually moving from the external morality to the inner morality of the mind. And this is again one of those things that is kind of unique to Buddhist ideas and Buddhist practice. That morality stretches to how you deal with your inner world and your inner life as well. That is part of morality. You have to avoid getting upset about things, to avoid too many desires, in this way, to be content. So when you are content with what you have, it dampens down all of these things. and it becomes very, yeah, just, you kind of go through the client in a very smooth and very nice way. And there are some remarkable examples of people in the present day who live like this. And one of the great examples was a monk in Sri Lanka called, it was of German origin, it was called Ñanavimala, and he passed away a few years ago. And he was, many people said he was an Arya, or perhaps even an Arahanta. He was very, very highly regarded there. And he, his life was basically a life of just walking around the island of Sri Lanka. Yeah, his first 10 years, he started off in a place called the Island Hermitage. And he stayed there learning the suttas, learning the basics of meditation practice. And then after that, he took the suttas, because he had learned the suttas by heart, so he kind of carried them around in his head. And then he walked around the island for 35 years or something, just wandering around. All he had with him was basically ropes and balls. That was it. Yeah, and very, very simple. And one of the on one occasion, there was one of his supporters, they wanted to help him, yeah, support him. They wanted to find out where exactly he was going, so they could kind of meet him down the road or something. Yeah. They saw him walking towards a crossroad, and they asked him, "Well, when you come to that crossroad, which way will you go, so we can look after you afterwards?" And he says, "I don't know. I will find out when I get there." Yeah, yeah. Living in the present moment, you don't kind of make any decisions prior to time. Yeah. And this is kind of an incredible simplicity here. Yeah. And he expressed that obviously through his ability to, through his insight and through his meditation practice as well. And the similar kind of things, you know, people like Ajahn Brahm, who spent 6 months in his little hut, for 6 months all by himself. He didn't speak to a single person for 6 months. All he had was a 7 square meter hut and a walking path outside. And that was it. That's all he did for 6 months. And most people would go absolutely nuts in that kind of situation. But Ajahn Brahm came out of that, 6 months of bliss. That was his first talk when he came out of this thing. He couldn't talk to begin with. He had forgotten how to talk. That's quite nice, isn't it? He can't talk anymore. He can completely silent. And he literally, it wasn't so much that he couldn't speak, he knew the word, but his mind was so peaceful, he just wasn't able to kind of, get it out, basically. And then he kind of had a headache for a couple of days because he was trying to kind of use his brain again. And then he gave this talk of 6 months of this. And this is what happens. And there are many other examples of people. And there's also the famous nun Tenzin Palmo, who stayed in a little cave in Nepal or Tibet or something.
Okay.
What was it?
India.
India, okay, so in that area. And in Cave in the Snow, I think her famous book is called, said it for over 3 years in this one little cave. 12, was it 12 years? Really? But I got it completely wrong. I've actually read the book, you see. I just kind of, I know about it, basically. And it's also very impressive. So you find this in certain people, not many, but certain people who live up to these kind of ancient standards. And when you read about these things, you kind of start to get inspired by it. It's inspiring because you know that to be able to live like that and still be happy, still be serene, still have metta and compassion for the world. But the only way you can do that is to draw the happiness from inside of yourself. That's the only way. The external life is just so simple and so basic. It has to come from inside. Yeah? And it gives you this feeling that there is something more in this world. There's something far more than what ordinary people live for. Yeah, I would like to get that for most people. And you get this powerful feeling that there's something in this world really worth striving for. It gives you that happiness. It comes from inside of you, not being dependent on the uncertain external realities. We're also dependent on the external world. The external world is so unreliable. It's terrible to depend on something which is so unreliable. Yeah, so to be able to draw these things from inside of yourself and to a far greater and deeper extent than you can in the external world. It's so powerful. And you get this feeling when you see these kind of things in real life. It's it gives rise to a sense of confidence and faith that this path really has something to offer, which is literally out of this world. Yeah, it's just really, really beyond what most people can really even start to comprehend usually. So this is kind of this beautiful idea of contentment. Yeah, this is where the mind starts to calm down and your defilement starts to kind of settle down a little bit. And this is not just for monastics, you can do this in lay life as well to some extent. Instead of always striving for more, too many people in this world is endlessly striving for things, striving for social position, striving for possessions, striving for advancement in your career, all these things. And in the middle of all that striving, guess what happens? You die. Yeah? And then you die. And then because you have all this striving and all this craving inside of yourself, you kind of, when you get born, you're already running when you get born. Then you continue with that striving into your next life. Yeah? You carry on. More striving in the next life. And you keep on doing this again and again and again. And the reason why I do it again is that every life it seems so important. It seems so necessary. Yeah, I've got to get these things done. I've got to get all this thing. Everything seems like it's a real goal. It's a real purpose. But actually, the only place you're going is to your grave. Yeah. And when you go to your grave, you do it again. Then you go to your grave again, and you do it again. Because then you go to your grave, and then you kind of keep on doing that. And after a while, you think this is madness. Yeah, we're not going anywhere. It's kind of completely pointless running around. There's a rat race without any kind of meaning to it. That's what it looks like. It seems so important in this life. I've been there, done that. I've been to university, kind of studying for degrees, kind of having mapped out my future. Yeah, this is really important and purposeful. It's complete nonsense. And the reason why you can't see it is because you don't see the big picture. You don't understand what's going on. Yeah, so then you realize, actually, why am I wasting my time running after all these empty things? They're not going to go take you anywhere. There's absolutely no goal or purpose or aim to these things, except for doing more of exactly the same. And then you start to think, well, maybe then the right approach is to be content with what I have already. Yeah, with whatever material possessions I have, whatever relationship I have, whatever social status or work status, whatever it is I have, maybe I should just be content with that. Maybe it's good enough. And instead, work on the spiritual aspects of life. Yeah, live fairly simply. Well, you don't even have to live simply. You can live exactly the way you like, but whatever it is, be content with what you have. And that kind of makes life easy. It makes it so much smoother. It makes it so much less striving, so much less always agitated, always restless, moving on from one thing to the next one. And it makes your mind even, smooth, and everything kind of so much more pleasant because of that. This is the idea of contentment. It's the beginning of meditational practice. Kind of creating a mind state that is suitable for samadhi, for samatha, for all of these things. So please try if you can do that in your own life as well. It is really, really worthwhile. I find it always so kind of worrying when people are striving for all these empty things. It kind of should be fairly obvious. Yeah, we're all going to die fairly soon. Life is usually fairly short. And then you die, and then what? With all the stuff that you have accumulated. It's pointless when you die. It's completely meaningless. You have to leave it all behind. Focus on those things you can take with you. The things you can take with you when you die is your qualities of your heart. The mental faculties that you have developed. That's what you take with you into the future. Focus on that. Learn to live in a way where these things are developed instead. It's very obvious when you think about it, just that nobody seems to think about it properly. Yeah, we kind of all follow along like sheep. Yeah, okay, do this, get money, get whatever. Yeah, it's kind of madness after a while. Right? That's really what we are. We like to think that we are independent and free, but actually, we're just following on the norms of society, the vast majority of us. And then, when you have that kind of contentment, then you have the right life movement as a monastic, and then you possess this sum total, the sum of a noble virtue, the Arya Sila, and you experience within yourself the bliss that is blameless, or if you like, the bliss of blamelessness, which I prefer as a translation. It is the bliss of blamelessness, because when you are blameless, you feel a natural sense of happiness, yeah? And this is the point in here. You are here, you're starting to feel also the inner happiness coming from the inner virtue as well. So, that is contentment. Now, we can move on to more to the sixth factor of the Noble Eightfold Path, which is right affection. And this is a very important part of the path of what we need to move forward in meditation in particular. We need to have the right attitudes of mind, the right mental state to be able for meditation to work. Yeah. So this is why this is actually so significant. And normally the way that right effort is described, it's described as basically as increasing the good qualities and reducing your bad qualities. Yeah. And an important part of that is this thing which is normally called sense restraint in the suttas. It's called the indriya samvara sila in Pali. Virtue of the morality of the character trait, which is the restraint of the senses, indriya samvara, restraint of the senses. And this next paragraph then is really what that is about. And this is what it sounds like. This is how, and I'll spend a little bit of time to explain how this works, because it is not that obvious when you just read it out. On seeing a form with the eye, one does not grasp at its signs and features. Since if you leave the eye faculty unguarded, evil, unwholesome states of covetousness and grief might invade you. You practice the way of its restraint. You guard the eye faculty. You undertake the restraint of the eye faculty. So I'll stop there and explain what is going on. Can everyone hear me okay? Does it sound good? Okay, yeah, good. So, on seeing the form with the eye, this just means that you see anything, yeah? Anytime you see anything, you are seeing a form, because we always see forms. Everything has shapes and that sort of thing. That's all it means, really, form. It means shapes that we see with the eye here. So when you see a form with the eye, very often we have a reaction to the things that we see. Yeah, not just what we see, but of course, anything that comes through the senses. And that reaction that we have, and this is what this is really all about, it can be to any aspect of the form. This is why it says here the signs and the features. It sounds pretty kind of a bit cryptic in English, yeah? You don't grasp the sign and the feature. But really all it means that you either grasp everything that you see, yeah, the whole kind of object, what you see, or some aspect of that. So for example, if you see a person, yeah, and you find a person a bit attractive, so either maybe you like the whole person, or you like a certain aspect, you like the hair or whatever it is. Yeah, so this is what it means, seeing the signs and the features. There's something in what you see that you are grasping onto. So what does it mean to grasp onto? Yeah, it says here, you grasp. You do not grasp, it says. This is what it says. If you grasp, you get it wrong. If you don't grasp, that's when you get it right. What does grasping mean? How do you know that you have grasped the signs and the features? And the way you know that is if the mind lingers on something. Yeah. So if you, for example, you see someone you like, and your mind kind of stops there, and you think about it, you reflect on it, you indulge in that kind of idea that this person is attractive or whatever. People is obviously a very important part of where we linger on things. Yeah. And whenever your mind lingers on it, that's where you have grasped it. The person may already have gone out of view, but it may still linger in your mind as a consequence of you grasping onto it. And the grasping can be two types of grasping. Either it can be you are attracted to the person and there is a degree of desire involved in the grasping, or it can be the exact opposite. You have aversion to the person and you kind of grasp that a negative aspect, and then you kind of you get a bit of negativity in your mind as a consequence. Both of these are grasping, like a negative grasping and a positive grasping, negative desire and positive desire. So notice how you see things, you linger on that thing, yeah, it is so common, it is so very difficult. If you don't linger on anything, that's when you have mindfulness, yeah. Mindfulness is where you go smoothly through the world, from one thing to another one, never really holding on to anything in the past, but always moving on from one thing to the next one. That is real mindfulness. Yeah, very hard to make that, perfect that. It's almost impossible in many ways, but you can kind of move towards that at the very least. But always moving on, always being what is happening now, not kind of holding on to anything from the past. That is what mindfulness is really about. So here the job is to not grasp onto these things, so that mindfulness can become a consequence of this. Yeah, this is the purpose here. So, how do we do this? You do not grasp the signs of the features. And the reason you don't do that, because if you do it, if you leave the eye faculty unguarded, then evil, unwholesome states of covetousness and grief might invade you. Evil, unwholesome states of covetousness and grief. That is just about the worst translation. I was going to say in samsara, that would be an exaggeration. It is very bad translation because it doesn't really mean very much. First of all, evil, okay, bad, probably better, bad, unwholesome states, not 100%, I prefer qualities, mental qualities. But the last part here, covetousness and grief, that is really the terrible one. Because that has got nothing to do with grief, means you feel sad because of someone has died or something, that's grief, It's got nothing to do with that at all. And what it means really is precisely what I was saying before. You're either attracted to the object of your attention, or you are repelled by it. You have aversion towards it. So it means like desire and aversion. That's really what it means. Or like and dislike, like another way of translating it. It does not mean covetousness. And here, the word covetousness in English, does anyone use covetousness anymore? It's pretty rare. outdated. But it's like, what does it say? Isn't it kind of, I don't know much about the Ten Commandments, but is there something about thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's property or something like that? Something like that in the Ten Commandments, And what it means like desire the property of other people. That's what covetousness really means. It has a very specialized meaning here. But really here, it means desire, because these words in Pali are often quite flexible, the way they are used. So you avoid desire and aversion from arising in the mind. This is what this is about. So bad, unwholesome qualities of desire and aversion. Perhaps you wonder, why is it? This has been translated by Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi, actually by Venerable Nanamoli, first of all. And Venerable Nanamoli was an English monk who lived in Sri Lanka back in the 1950s. And he was very, very good with languages. You know, he was almost like a genius with languages. And Bhikkhu Bodhi himself is pretty good too, to say the least. So these are very good, superb translators in so many ways. How come they get it wrong? Who am I to sit here instead of these kind of supremes translating what is wrong? Why do I have to say that? That's the kind of question you should ask me. Who do you think you are? be honest. Just kind of get it. And the reason why it is possible to criticize people, even if they are far better translators than I am, the reason why it is possible is because, first of all, nobody gets everything perfect. There's always things that can be changed, can be done better. Secondly, there's many different angles of looking at anything from. You can look at things from this angle, that angle. There's no such thing as a perfect translation. And that's why when you see different translations, you understand better what's going on. Thirdly, the philosophy that you use, or the theory that you use to translate it, will dictate what comes out of your translations. And one of the philosophies used by both Venerable Nanamoli and Bhikkhu Bodhi is the idea of each word in Pali should be translated by one word in English. And that constrains you enormously, and often it means that you end up with translations that are, because words in the Pali can have many different meanings, in some context it will turn out to be complete nonsense. It won't actually make any sense. So it constrains the way you translate, and then it actually doesn't come out as a good translation. So I'm not kind of trying to prove that I'm better than these translators. I'm just pointing out that every translation has its drawbacks and its limits. And that's why it is okay, to sometimes be praise the vast majority of what they do, but occasionally the critical is actually perfectly okay. So, desire and aversion is what you want to avoid, because that's what happens when you use your senses. I'm sure all of you know exactly what I'm talking about. You see something, you feel desire, or you see something else, and you feel aversion towards it. That happens all the time. Because of that, because you want to avoid this, you practice restraint. You guard the eye faculty, undertake the restraint of the eye faculty. So what does this mean? What does it mean that you guard the eye faculty? And what it means is that you have mindfulness. That's really what it means. You haven't got supreme mindfulness yet, because the degree of mindfulness becomes enhanced all the time as you go down the path. It becomes stronger and stronger. Now, at this point, you just have enough mindfulness to be able to have a rough idea of what's going on in your mind. Yeah, that's really what it is about here. Now, it's not a very powerful mindfulness, but a certain degree of mindfulness. So that is what it means. You guard. Yeah, you are aware of what's happening. Don't allow yourself to be dragged around too much by these things. You have a feeling of awareness around you. The idea here is to have as much awareness as you possibly can, so you can catch these aversions and things come as soon as possible. Because if your aversion kind of turns into ill will, you know how these things are, and suddenly it has infested your mind so strongly. And when you get really angry about something, it's almost impossible to get rid of. Yeah, it kind of establishes itself in your mind, or you get a very strong desire. You look at something, you kind of, and once it is there, once it's kind of established itself in your mind, you can't get rid of it anymore. So you have to get rid of it very early on. And that's why it's important to have as strong mindfulness as you possibly can. The earlier you catch into it, the easier it is to deal with it. This is why when you go on a retreat, and hopefully your mindfulness becomes a bit more powerful, it's easier at this point to deal with the defilements of the mind. You can see how tricky this is. Yeah, especially in daily life, you get really busy. So many things happening. It's so hard to actually practice these kind of things in daily life. So because of that, I'm going to talk more about strategies later on for how to deal with these things. But now is a good time to lay down the basic strategies so that you kind of are ready when you kind of come back, go back later on, back to your job, back to your family, and all these kind of things. So first thing is to guard the eye faculty. That happens by through mindfulness. The second thing then, if you see something goes wrong, is then to restrain it. What does it mean to restrain? And this is kind of a tricky one, because restraint normally in the English language means using force. Yeah, you take out a restraining order against somebody who is kind of hassling you too much. Yeah, the kind of a stalker, whatever these people do, and they kind of walking up to you. So you take out a restraining order. Yeah, so okay, you cannot come within a kilometer of me. If you walk 1 meter inside a kilometer, the police will come and get you. It's all about force. And so restraint has this feeling of using force. And we have to be very careful to interpret these things in the right way. Because again, Pali word and English word don't overlap 100%. So even though restraint is a fairly good translation, there's not absolute overlap. So you need to read the context to understand what is going on there. So what does restraint mean? And what restraint really means here is to avoid those things from arising here. It doesn't say anything about the method that we have to use. So when it says restraint, it doesn't mean you have to use force. Whatever method you use to avoid these things is right. And what is so interesting, this is what comes out, we'll see that in the sutta that comes up very soon, that the main method used by the Buddha is not willpower. The main method used by the Buddha to restrain the senses and to avoid anger, ill will, aversion, desire to arise is wisdom. Yeah, it's right reflection. If you reflect in the right way, that is when you overcome these things. And again, it's so wonderful because I've always been the kind of, Ajahn Brahm is my teacher. Ajahn Brahm says, this is how you do things. And I think, yeah, whatever, yeah, sure. Yeah. You're always a bit skeptical. You never take things on board 100%. And Ajahn Brahm was always going about wisdom power, yeah, not willpower. Yeah. And I always thought he was kind of, I always think Ajahn Brahm was exaggerating. I don't know why, that's kind of what I think. Yeah. And because he has a very kind of strong personality, this is the way it is. Okay. But then you read in the sutras. Yeah, and it turns out, of course, as usually, he's right and I'm wrong. It turns out right there it is. Yeah, use wisdom power, don't use willpower. Yeah. And it's always such a relief when you see that the way someone teaches, your teacher did, actually fits very, very well with the Buddha. It's actually, it's a wonderful thing when it happens, because it strengthens your confidence in both, really, at the same time. The whole thing kind of gets elevated one notch when that happens. So wisdom power is the way to deal with these things. And I will show you later on exactly how to use wisdom power to the best of your ability to overcome these defilements when they arise in the mind. It's such an important part of the path, because if you can avoid the defilements, everything becomes very smooth. Yeah. And then when you sit down, your mind is already ready. Yeah. And then the calm and the peace and all of these things tend to arise as a consequence. So this is a theory. Yeah. Okay. So that is the eye. Yeah. This is how you deal with the eye. And of course, the, all the other senses are exactly the same. So on hearing a sound with the ear, on smelling an odor with the nose, on tasting a flavor with the tongue, on touching a tangible with the body, on cognizing a mind object with the mind. Yeah, you do not grasp its signs and features, since it left the mind faculty unguarded, bad, unwholesome qualities of desire and aversion might invade you. You practice the way of its restraint using wisdom power. You guard the mind faculty with mindfulness, and you undertake the wisdom power restraint of the mind faculty. I could have added a bit there just to make it clear. So, again, for all the six senses, including the mind. Yeah. So, what this means, of course, is that if you are sitting there in meditation practice, yeah, and you have these defilements arise while you're meditating because you are, you know, focusing on something in the wrong way or remembering something from the past or whatever, because of that, in meditation, you do exactly the same thing. You use this wisdom power right here, right now, as you do your meditation practice. Sometimes you will hear that, you know, there are the six faculties, or the six faculties, it is the mind faculty is kind of different. But the mind faculty very often reflects the other five faculties. It says in one of the sutras in the Majjhima, I think it's the Mahavidhamma Sutra, where it says that the mind faculty takes the objects of the other five faculties. Yeah, so for example, you see something, and afterwards you dream about it. And when you dream about it, it's still, you're still seeing it, but you're not seeing it with your eye, you're seeing it in your mind. So your mind can take the other five faculties as its objects. And that is why the same kind of problem arises in the mind as well. But when the mind gets purified, yeah, you start to get the happiness and things, that's when you are entering the mind faculty, released completely from the other five faculties. That's kind of where we are trying to go. That's what really meditation is all about. So you guard also the mind faculty. Possessing this noble restraint of the faculties, you experience within yourself the bliss that is unsullied. So solid means like dirty, yeah, it means like it's an unclean kind of bliss. The previous bliss, when it said that it's a bliss of blamelessness, you are perhaps blameless, but because the mind still has a bit of desire and aversion in there, it is as if it is a kind of dirty, yeah, it has kind of smudges, if you like, smudged by the defilements of the mind, yeah, this is a problem. But so you purify the mind as well. When you purify the mind, then the bliss is unsullied. Yeah, it is no longer dirtied by the unclean mind. And as you do this, you're experiencing a higher degree of bliss, a higher degree of happiness. And the Pali word is sutta. Yeah, this is one of those wonderful things that you start to read the sutta. One of the things that I always found so beautiful. You start off with a path, you start off by practicing just ordinary virtue, and then you feel the happiness of blamelessness. Yeah? This is already straight away here. There's a degree of happiness there coming into your practice. Then you do sense restraint and increase the happiness. You get the unsolid happiness. Yeah. And then you go down and the rest of the path just continues like that, stage by stage by stage. Every time you get the meditation right, every time you get the practice right, you feel a new and more elevated state of happiness. It's all about happiness really here. And this is something which is so important to point out and which is so often forgotten in Buddhist circles. Yeah? And I think it is an important criticism of Buddhism that often it sounds kind of very dour and heavy. Yeah, no suffering or you know, we can't overcome suffering, whatever. But actually, when you read the suttas, they're not like that. They actually have a lot of positive images and positive emotions that they talk about all the time. And here they are, right there, even from the very beginning of the path, you're supposed to experience degrees of happiness. It's such a wonderful thing. And when you kind of get that, it becomes very attractive, of course. So morality is always a positive thing. It's always something very, very beautiful for ourselves and for others as well. This is how it becomes a spiritual thing. Yeah. So that is the practice of sense restraint. And I'm going to talk a lot about how to do this in practice tomorrow. But before I do that, I'm going to have a quick look at this next paragraph also, before I quit this sutta for a while, then we come back to the sutta later on. This next paragraph is about sampajanya. Sampajanya is another important part of the Buddhist practice. It is here called full awareness, sometimes called clear comprehension. And it's something you see many places in the suttas. So this is how it goes. You become one who acts in full awareness when going forward and returning. Who acts in full awareness when looking ahead and looking away. Who acts in full awareness when flexing and extending your limbs. Who acts in full awareness when wearing your robes and carrying your outer robe and bowl. Who acts in full awareness when eating, drinking, consuming food and tasting it. Who acts in full awareness when defecating and urinating it. Who acts in full awareness when walking, standing, sitting, falling asleep, waking up, talking and keeping silent. So that is the usual passage of full awareness that you find in the suttas. The point here again, you can see that this is about monastic practice, but just because it is about monastic practice here does not mean it doesn't apply to everyone. It applies to everyone. The focus here is on the monastic practice. And perhaps you wonder, what are all these things? What is all this doing? What things? What's going on? What is this thing about looking ahead and looking away, going forward and returning? It kind of sounds a bit strange. Look at the way it's phrased. You wonder what's going on. And what is going on here? And these are the standard ways. And the first part here, the standard ways of talking about monks or nuns when they go into the village for alms food. Yeah? You go forward and you come back. You look out. Yeah? Am I going to receive alms food or not? So this is the vocabulary that is used in the suttas when you go for your alms round. So you have full awareness when you go on alms round. Yeah? And all of these other things coming down the list here, wearing your robes, carrying your outer robe and bowl, drinking and sleeping and whatever else, all of these things, these are all the things that you do in monastic life apart from your meditation practice. Yeah, this is how you deal with life when you're not meditating, basically. Yeah? And when you're meditating, you also have full awareness. Yeah, so really, it goes everywhere. But this is especially here, the focus is especially here on the time outside of your meditation practice. So this is when you have full awareness. What does it mean to have full awareness? In what sense do we have full awareness? And this is not really explained all that much in the suttas, but it's explained in the commentaries, and there's a fourfold aspect to full awareness as the commentaries explain, and actually it is quite useful, and I think very pertinent, at least two of those four aspects which I like to focus on. And those two main aspects are full awareness in terms of the purpose of what you're doing and the suitability of what you're doing. Yeah, so if you go into the village for alms, yeah, as a monk, what is the purpose? Well, the purpose is to collect alms food. Yeah, and am I doing that in a suitable way? Is it going to kind of achieve the purpose that I'm trying to do? So when you go into the village, it's not to kind of look around and kind of see all the sights, all the signboards, or looking at all the kind of the pretty women or whatever. That's kind of not the purpose of being monastic. Yeah. So you know what you're doing, and then you try to fulfill the purpose of that in the right way as you go into the village. This is what it really is about. Yeah, and when you do that, then of course you're able to avoid kind of defilements arising in the mind because you're doing what is suitable. Yeah, as a monk, you don't go to the casino, for example. Actually, I've been to a casino as a monk. Yeah. It's true. Some years ago, my parents, they came all the way to Australia and said, we want to take you somewhere. We'll take you to China. They said, okay, I'll come along because my parents are kind of inviting me. So we ended up on the way to China, we ended up in Hong Kong and said, well, what are we going to do here? We haven't been to Macau before, let's go to Macau. Mm-hmm. So we went to Macau, because Macau was one of the great gambling one massive gambling den, really, Macau. Actually, it's not. Macau is also a very charming place because it is an ancient kind of halfway Portuguese, half Chinese city. It's a very charming place, actually, in some ways. A bit run down, a bit quite charming. But apart from that charm, it has all these massive casinos, really lovely ones. And my parents took me to this brand new casino called the Venetian. I think it was the biggest casino in the world or something at the time. And they took us in, and when they saw me, these kind of people had this look in their eyes as if they were getting a bit scared.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is an age, I don't know what the monk looks like straight away. Yeah, they knew I was a Buddhist monk. But this monk, I'm not supposed to go to casinos. It is bad, apparently it is bad for the gamblers if they see a Buddhist monk in a casino. It's bad fortune, yeah? Buddhist monks, please stay out. Getting a bit excited now, of course. So please stay out of the casino. Ajahn Brahm had this idea, we're talking about how to fundraise. You know, one of the fundraising projects Ajahn Brahm has been involved in is the Anukampa project, which is run by Venerable Chanda. And it's a wonderful project to kind of establish a good Bhikkhuni Sangha here in the UK. And I hope that it will be successful in the long run. It's a great opportunity to get good monastics and a good practice in the UK. It's a wonderful thing to do. So Ajahn Brahm had this idea of how to fundraise for Anukampa. I'm not sure if it was actually for that, but one of these projects that he's involved in, yeah? He's involved in some of the things. And the idea was, you stand yourself outside one of these casinos, and then if you don't want to move, then you say, well, you know, I might move against the donation, yeah? And then we kind of get the donation, then we kind of leave, yeah? This was kind of one of his ideas for fundraising. He was not being serious, I'm just kind of, he was just messing around as usual, so. But anyway, I went into this casino in Macau, and I realized straight away why this is a very bad idea for monastics. One of the worst places I've ever been in my life. It was just so terrible. You go inside, first of all, I knew very quickly I shouldn't go in on the gambling floor, so I asked the personnel, is there a way of kind of avoid the gambling floor and go into the rest of the casino? Because these casinos are enormous. They have hotels, they have all this kind of fancy shops, they have all lots of restaurants, all of this kind of very expensive and fancy stuff in there. But the only way to get in there is usually through the gambling floor, yeah? For good reason, because people kind of get trapped on the gambling floor as they go in there. So they showed me the back route, and the back route was, because they had to have a back route according to law, but it was so hidden, it was impossible to find it for yourself. That they shone through this back corridor, it's going like a maze in, and finally, kind of got into this place. And they are very unpleasant places to be in my opinion. They always have this kind of atmosphere which is slightly dark and slightly unpleasant, even though it was very luxurious in some ways. And you kind of get this feeling that people are really not happy, yeah? They're kind of addicted to gambling or whatever. It's kind of this unhappy atmosphere, like hungry ghosts or something like that. And the atmosphere inside, even though we went there in the morning, it always has an evening atmosphere inside. Because if you have the evening atmosphere, that's when you gamble, right? So we had this massive kind of sky with kind of little starlight in it, yeah? Even though it was early in the morning. Yeah? It was so enormous, this place, that it was absolutely ridiculous. And this feeling was really terrible. And then I understood why it is not a good idea to kind of go to casinos. I missed them after that, and why it is a very bad idea for monastics to go to these things. So there are things you know that when you are in certain places in life, that actually it goes against the idea of mindfulness. And the very purpose of a place like a casino of this was to distract you, to make you unmindful, to kind of make you follow your defilements. Yeah? Everything was about kind of making you use money on the gambling floor. That was basically the idea of this casino. Yeah, you could feel the kind of the pull, yeah? And you kind of didn't take long before you lost your bearings, you know, up from down. And you can see how people would lose their money very quickly. Very, very unpleasant, but very contrary to the ideas of the Buddhist path. So I escaped fairly quickly from that one. I think the casino was very happy to see me go, to be honest. So I got out of there. So this is the thing, you know where your mindfulness gets lower, you know where your defilements get caught, and you avoid those things. And this is then what you do in the monastic life, but also in lay life. You know what kind of situations get you into trouble, where your defilements kind of come out because of that situation, so you avoid those things. you know that your real purpose in life is to have a peaceful mind, to be a kind and good character. This is what you really want for your life. If you have a bit of wisdom, you will know that that's the point of everything. So you avoid those situations where the other aspects of the personality are drawn out. So that is the purpose of this. So all of these things are about that. With eating, drinking, and consuming food and tasting, the same thing. You have full awareness. You know how much to eat, and not to eat too little, not to eat too much, and just the right amount. So it kind of carries you on without being a problem. Then we have the very last part here. I like this kind of earthiness of the sutta as well. You have full awareness when defecating in urine. They're very earthy. It kind of is very realistic about life. This is one of the great things about the sutta. You don't kind of hide things behind the facade. You are realistic about the nature of existence. Full awareness when walking, standing, sitting, falling asleep. And this is actually quite an interesting part, this idea of falling asleep and waking up. What does it mean to have full awareness when falling asleep and waking up? And actually, you can't have full awareness when you fall asleep, because at that point, awareness is gone, So, actually, this is a mistranslation. And the Pali here, sutta, is actually the Pali behind this. And sutta means actually being asleep. So, if you were to translate this literally, it would mean something like you have full awareness while you are sleeping, and then you have full awareness while you are awake. But that doesn't make any sense either, because how can you have full awareness while you are sleeping here? If nobody has full awareness while they're sleeping, even Arahants or the Buddha don't have that. When you sleep, you are, by definition, don't have full awareness. That's what sleep is. So this shows you the nuances here in translation that are possible. One way, I think the correct way of translating this is a particular grammatical construction, and you have to know a bit of grammar to understand how this is to be constructed or construed in the right way. It actually means you act in full awareness in regard to these things, in regard to walking, in regard to standing, in regard to sitting, in regard to sleeping, in regard to being awake. And suddenly it makes very good sense. If you have full awareness in regard to being awake or in regard to sleeping, it just means that you know how much you're supposed to sleep. You know the right time for sleeping, the right time for being awake. Suddenly the whole thing comes together very beautifully here. And that, I think, is actually the right translation in this particular case. All of these things that are read out should actually be read as in regard to or about, rather than when, which is used here. And then the meaning comes out very beautifully here. And it is interesting again, why is it that someone like Ikebodhi makes this kind of, I would say it is a mistake, it's a small mistake, but nevertheless it is a mistake. Why do these things happen? And one of the reasons why these things happen is that this particular formula right here is also found in the Satipatthana Sutta. Most of you would know about the Satipatthana Sutta. It's one of the suttas quoted the most frequently from the Sutta Pitaka. Some people say it is the most important sutta in the Sutta Pitaka. Why they say that, I don't know, because there's no evidence internal to the sutta to suggest that. It is just somebody decided it was the most important one, and then it became the most important one. That's usually how these things happen. But actually, there's no reason for thinking that. It is just as important or unimportant as any other sutta, really. But the Satipatthana Sutta is because that formula is found in the Satipatthana Sutta, and Satipatthana is about being mindful and aware of things, Not thinking, not about things or in respect of things, but actually being aware of things as they are, that is why you get this kind of interpretation. It is considered to be part of Satipatthana practice. But the interesting question is it really part of Satipatthana practice? What I'm saying now may not be of interest to all of you, because this is quite technical, but I find these things extraordinarily fascinating, because it shows something about the evolution of the suttas, how they have evolved over long periods of time. And I don't know if any one of you have, there's a very interesting book out by Bhante Sujato, who is staying at Bodhidharma Monastery in Perth right now. who has translated all the four Nikayas in a book called The History of Mindfulness. A book that he wrote over 10 years ago, and it's available online. And it's quite technical, and you have to have a really deep understanding of the suttas to be able to appreciate it. But if you do appreciate it, one of the things that he does there, he makes an historical argument on how the Satipatthana Sutta has been expanded over time. That the original Satipatthana Sutta was actually much shorter than the Satipatthana Sutta as we have it now. And there are very good reasons for thinking so. And the reasons are because the Satipatthana Sutta exists in different versions, in the Chinese, in the Pali, in various places. And because the versions are not exactly the same, it looks like there has been a historical evolution, and it has expanded. Yeah, and one of the passages that have been expanded is precisely this passage here. This passage probably does not originally belong to the Satipatthana Sutta. Yeah, but because it has ended up in the Satipatthana Sutta, it is assumed that you have to be mindful of these things all the time, and that's why you have got this translation. You have full awareness when you are doing these things. But actually, if you take it out of that context and see it in this context instead, it makes far better sense to translate it as in regard to these things. So I think the reason why it's translated in this way is very interesting, that the evolution of one sutta has actually caused people to be slightly deceived, if you like, of the real purpose of these things. So just to show you that what happens is sometimes you get small corruptions in the suttas, and small corruptions can actually have an effect on how you translate things, on the understanding of things, until you get something which doesn't really make any sense anymore. And the reason why Bhikkhu Bodhi has translated as here as full awareness when falling asleep is because full awareness when sleeping didn't make any sense. So you have chosen falling asleep, but Pali word doesn't mean falling asleep, it actually means sleeping. And this is the problem. So you interpret things in a way which isn't really acceptable because of the way that the suttas have kind of evolved over time, causes you to misunderstand what is going on. I find these things very exciting. I don't know about you, but to me this is really kind of little things in the suttas which when we pull it apart, suddenly comes together just right. And you feel quite confident that you have actually understood what is really going on there. So that is the passage on full awareness or clear comprehension. I would recommend all of you to think about that. This is something that you use in your ordinary life, but you also use it in your meditation practice. So like when you're watching the breath, are you doing what is suitable? Are you fulfilling the purpose of your meditation? Are you on the breath? Are you thinking about random stuff? This is kind of this is what it's all about. If you are following the breath, then you are doing what is suitable and purposeful. If your mind is thinking about things, well then, you have lost a little bit of the purpose of what you're doing. So throughout your life, you can use this idea of being fully aware or clearly comprehending about what is going on. I will stop there with this particular sutta, and now we will move on to the next sutta of this list. I think I will just read out this sutta as well because it's very short and it's very easy to explain. This is the one where it says AM2.12, which is coming up next day. Should be the next one in your sheets. Now I want to talk in more detail about this idea of sensory strength, how to deal with the mind, how to overcome the defilements, etc. of the mind. This sutta is interesting because it builds up under the idea I had before about how to use wisdom power and reflection and contemplation rather than willpower in our practice. So this is what the Buddha has to say. Bhikkhus, monks, there are these two powers. What two? The power of reflection and the power of development. Reflection is patisankhana, probably a word you've never heard of before, but patisankhana, I reckon. Development is bhavana, which may very well be a word you have heard before. It is used very commonly in the Buddhist world to refer to meditation practice itself. So power of reflection and power of development. And what is the power of reflection then? Here someone reflects thus. Bodily misconduct has a bad result in the present life and in the future life or in future lives. Verbal misconduct has a bad result in the present life and in future lives. Mental misconduct has a bad result in the present life and in future lives. Having reflected thus, you abandon bodily misconduct and develop good bodily conduct. You abandon verbal misconduct and develop verbal good conduct. You abandon mental misconduct and develop good mental conduct. You maintain yourself in purity. This is called the power of reflection. Yeah? So what this means is that you use your ability to consider things carefully, to contemplate things, to reflect on things. In other words, you are using the wisdom, whatever wisdom you have, yeah, to move your mind in the right direction. You understand how when you do something bad, it has bad consequences. It always does. It has certainly has bad consequences for you, but it also often has bad consequences for other people. And you get that, and you get it in a deep way. You reflect upon it again and again and again until this reflection becomes a force in your practice. You try to figure out why exactly is it so bad? Why is anger counterproductive? Why doesn't it work out? Why is it kind of cause problems? And the more you understand that, the deeper way you understand this, the easier it is to move away from it in the future. So you would notice here, the Buddha is not saying that the way to overcome anger and desire or any other bad qualities is to meditate. He doesn't say that. The way to overcome these things is through reflection, through using wisdom. Most people think that meditation is enough on the Buddhist path, and that will kind of solve all problems. But no, it won't. It's only when you think about these things in the right way that you actually resolve these issues. Of course, meditation can be helpful, because when you meditate, you become more peaceful, you get more clarity or whatever, yeah, so it can be helpful. But it is a reflection that actually does the work and helps you to see why these things are problematic. It also gives you tools and the strategy and the tactics for how to overcome these things. You understand why they are bad and then how to overcome them. Two factors are absolutely required. And you will notice here, not just is this about the verbal conduct and the bodily conduct, but also the mental conduct. Yeah? The way to think in the right way, if you want to think in the right way, you have to reflect to figure out how to do that. And this is what we're going to talk about very soon. How can you reflect in such a way so as to avoid ill will and anger in the future? If you can live a life without ill will and anger, wow, it is so much nicer, yeah? Otherwise, we're always kind of the world is always kind of pushing it back and forth, and buttons are being pushed all the time. But if you can live without anger, it is such a wonderful thing. And this is one of the things that I have noticed in my monastic life, yeah? In the old days, early days, I used to get kind of upset quite easily sometimes, you know, easily pushed my buttons. These days, I get upset much more, quite rarely, actually, not very often anymore. And it's so nice, it's so wonderful to be able to have that distance to the world, where you're able to kind of flow through things so much more easily. It's really pleasant. I have seen it work in my own life, and it has worked mostly precisely through reflecting in the right way, so I know it works. And I would really recommend you to try to do similar kind of things. So reflection, wisdom power, that is where it is all at. So that is the power of reflection, yeah? Not the power of control, the power of willpower, the power of wisdom power, the power of wisdom power, yeah, or whatever. What then is the power of development? Here, a bhikkhu, bhikkhuni, layperson, anyone, develops the awakening factor of mindfulness that is based upon seclusion, dispassion, and cessation, and which matures in release. You develop the awakening factor of discrimination of phenomena, or investigation of phenomena, if you like, dhammavicchaya. You develop the awakening factor of energy, the awakening factor of joy or rapture, the awakening factor of tranquility, the awakening factor of stillness, or something like that, not concentration. That's it. So So stillness, the only factor of equanimity that is based upon seclusion, dispassion, cessation, and maturing in release. This is called the power of development. These figures are the two powers. The power of development, this is all about meditation practice, starting off with mindfulness, satipatthana. This is when you start doing the breath meditation, yeah? So the moment you start doing the breath meditation, that is when you do the power of development. It has to do with the seven factors of awakening. It has to do with calm, it has to do with samadhi, it has to do with the four jhanas, all these kind of things. That is what is the power of development. You develop the mind. First of all, you overcome all the defilements and the problems. Once the defilements are down sufficiently, there's only a little bit left, that is where mindfulness becomes possible. Once mindfulness becomes possible, that is where the development of the mind starts. Yeah? The first factor of awakening is the mindfulness factor of awakening. It starts only when mindfulness has been established. Then you develop the mind in samadhi. That is the development of the mind. That is what meditation is all about. So meditation in Buddhism actually is a fairly profound thing. It is not, you know, most of us we say, oh yeah, I meditate a bit, and it's, of course, that's perfectly okay. Any kind of meditation is fine. But the real meditation, the meditation that the Buddha talks about, is a meditation that only starts when the mindfulness is already established. That is when it starts. That is when it's called meditation. Yeah? Yeah, the defilements are already kind of brought down and brought under control to a large extent. So that is the meditation part. All the samadhi, all the deeper aspects of meditation, that's what it's all about. The overcoming of the defilements is something completely different. Overcoming of the defilements happens through reflection. Some support of meditation, but basically reflection is the tool that makes you overcome those things. So very interesting. I think it's very interesting here. And so we will continue on this theme for the next two or three sessions or so, because I think it is a very important part of the path. And we are talking about in more detail how to use this. But that is all for now, and we'll see you back again this evening at 7 o'clock or thereabouts.